It is really a shame that there is only one sunset each day. Sitting down, watching the sunset with a special someone can make a beautiful moment, but you only get one chance each day. Or do you? I saw this animation about how to watch the sunset twice, and in the comments, people were debating whether either of these strategies could actually work. Could you go high enough and fast enough in the elevator of a tall skyscraper to watch the sunset twice? Or could you drive up a mountain in time to see it a second time? Other people were wondering how fast you would need to drive or fly towards the sunset to see it set twice. Well, let's do some math and find out. See if it actually is possible to see the sunset twice in the same day. There is an easy trick to see the sunset twice if you're near a mountain. The trick is to be near the base of a mountain on the east side. The sun will go behind the mountain, then you can drive over or around the mountain and you can watch it again. But that's not what we're exploring today. For today's exploration, we will build off of the math we used in a previous video where we calculated how far out to sea you can see while standing on the shore. We can start with the same assumptions, a perfectly spherical Earth with a radius of 6,378.1 kilometers. We can represent someone standing on the Earth and their line of sight at the horizon intersecting the Earth as a tangent line. And now at the moment that the sun falls below the horizon, then the line of sight would also fall tangent to the sun. We're ignoring any refraction or bending of light due to the atmosphere or gravity at this point. Gravity doesn't make a significant difference, but the refraction of light through the atmosphere does make a difference. The sun's light is bent by the atmosphere in the same way that light changes directions passing through glass or water. The bending is substantial. When the sun is setting and the bottom of the sun is starting to disappear, the sun is actually about halfway dipped beyond the horizon, but because of the refraction of the sun's light as it goes through the atmosphere, it appears higher than it actually is. But to keep the math simple, let's ignore that fact for now. With the sun barely behind the horizon, we can represent how high we would have to go to see the sunset again by drawing a line from the bottom of the sun tangent to the Earth and seeing where it would intersect a line right over my head. This is the distance we need to find. It wasn't clear to me how to proceed to find this distance here, dE. In the video where we calculated the distance we could see out into the ocean, it was a straightforward application of the Pythagorean theorem. This problem is not as straightforward, but I started by making right triangles to see how they might help. These are right triangles here, where the tangent lines to the Earth intersect a radius segment. I saw this right triangle and realized it could be a key to helping us solve this problem, but I only have one side and one angle. I either need another side length or another angle, so I started to see what angles I could calculate. The angle across the sun from Earth is fairly constant, and we could calculate that or look it up. The sun's about 150 million kilometers from Earth and has a diameter of about 1.4 million kilometers, so we can draw a simple right triangle and use arctangent to find that angle, and it's about a half of a degree. That means that these angles are all 0.53 of a degree. After some work, I realized that these two triangles are similar triangles. They're both right triangles and they share this angle, so by the angle-angle similarity criterion, they are similar. Now using the angle measure for these vertical angles, I can find all of the angle measures of the two triangles. These two smaller triangles are also right triangles, and I know one of the non-right angles, 0.53 degrees, so the last angle must be 90 degrees minus 0.53 degrees. That means the shared angle at A of the two similar triangles is 0.53, because it's 90 minus 90 minus 0.53. Or we could just as easily have shown that these four triangles are all similar, so their corresponding angle measures are congruent. Well, I can calculate this angle here, CAF, because I know the side lengths and it is the right triangle. Using arc cosine, I find that the angle is 0.043 degrees. Now I have a right triangle, EAG, with two angles. EGA is 90, GAE is 0.043 plus 0.53. And I have a side length, AG, is the radius of the Earth, 6,378.1 kilometers. I can use trigonometry now to find the length of the hypotenuse and subtract off the radius of the Earth and the height of my eyes to find the height we need to go to see the sunset again. In this triangle, AEG, I know the length of this leg, which is the radius of the Earth. I want the length of the hypotenuse, and I know this angle. Since this angle is between the hypotenuse and the side we know, we can use cosine. Cosine of this angle is AG divided by AE, so we can solve for AE. So we divide the radius of the Earth by the cosine of this angle and subtract off the radius of the Earth, since what we really want is CE. And we get a value of 0.319 kilometers. and it doesn't make much of a difference if we subtract off the height of my eyes or not. 319 meters to about 317 meters isn't much of a difference. So we need to go up quite a bit, almost 1,050 feet, which seems quite possible. There are buildings with floors that high. Now the question is, how fast do you need to go up the elevator to be able to catch the sunset? Before we look at the speed though, we know enough to take on this other scenario in the video. Could you stand up after lying down and watch the sunset a second time? Well, in the best case scenario, you'd get your eyes level with the Earth, so the sun sets at the earliest possible moment. That would mean your eyes are here, at letter F. And when you stand up, you need to see this far. We could use trigonometry in this right triangle in the same way we did earlier, but our angle is 0.53 degrees. We get a height of about 273 meters, so no, that isn't going to happen. You can't see the second sunset just by standing up. Let's get back to the speed of the elevator. The height we calculated that a person needed to rise, 319 meters or about 1,050 feet, assumes instantaneous movement. But the longer someone takes to go up, the higher they have to go to get the bottom of the sun to appear above the horizon again. How long does it take the sun to set? From just touching the horizon to disappearing behind the horizon, it only takes about 2 minutes. Since the Earth rotates 360 degrees every 24 hours, that's 15 degrees an hour, or about a quarter of a degree every minute. But since the sun takes up about half of a degree, it takes about 2 minutes of the Earth's rotation for it to drop below the horizon. That calculation is assuming someone is at the equator and at the spring or fall equinox. Depending on your latitude and the time of the year, it could take longer. Take this video, for example, taken in Corsica, France, where it takes about 3 minutes for the sun to completely set. It takes longer because it appears the sun is going down at an angle, and the shallower the angle, the longer it will take to set. Let's get a little more technical and see if we can create a function that tells us how high we need to go depending on the amount of time it takes us to get to that height. We can adapt our earlier work. To make this simple, let's assume our height is negligible, so we're starting here, but every minute the Earth rotates, we have a larger angle we need to use in our triangle to calculate the height. We calculated the height earlier by a process equivalent to this expression, but now our angle will depend on how many minutes it takes to get up the tower. We already found that the rotation of the Earth is about a quarter of a degree per minute, so we can write down the angle as 0.25t plus 0.53, where t is the number of minutes to go up the tower. We can make a table on a spreadsheet or use a graph to help us see what's going on. I made a table based on every 30 seconds, and these were the heights I was getting. Instantaneous, we have our 273 meters, which we had seen before when we were analyzing the stand-up method. We have 417 meters with a 30-second trip, 591 meters with a 1-minute trip, and we're already pushing the limits of reality here. The main observation deck of the Burj Khalifa, the tallest building in the world, is 452 meters above the ground. And it takes about 1 minute to take the elevators up to the observation deck, so it would be close. This is the worst case scenario though. If you do this at the right season, the sun will appear to set more slowly, so then our estimate of a quarter degree per minute is off. At certain times of the year, it'll be close to 3 minutes to set. In that case, we can change the rate the angle will grow from 0.25 degrees per minute to about 0.17 degrees per minute. With this new rate, the estimate is 476 meters for a 60-second elevator ride, so pretty close to the 452-meter observation deck. If any of our viewers live near the Burj Khalifa and can test out this finding around the next solstice, please report back and let us know. There are probably not that many places in the world where you could pull this off, though there are definitely mountains high enough. For example, overlooking the university where I teach, at Brigham Young University in Provo, Utah, there's a large Y on the mountain. From the base of the trail to the top of the Y, it's about 335 meters. There is enough elevation gain to see the sunset twice, but the hiking trail to get there is about 1.2 miles, or almost 2 kilometers long. No one's fast enough to run that in time to see even part of the sunset again. There might be a place where you could watch the sunset this way by driving. If you could drive up a mountain fast enough on a road that gains a lot of elevation, it might be possible. And if you know of such a place, put it in the comments. Speaking of driving, what about driving fast enough to see the sunset twice? Well, at the equator, you would need to drive 1,000 miles an hour, or about 1,600 kilometers an hour, just to make it appear that the sun is standing still. I quickly know that it's about 1,000 miles per hour because the circumference of the Earth is about 24,000 miles, and it takes about 24 hours to rotate once. You don't need to go quite as fast if you get closer to the poles, but even in Edmonton, Canada, it would be close to 1,000 kilometers an hour, or 600 miles an hour. This is not very realistic, even in your souped-up superstock Camaro. but it isn't that hard if you're a cartoon character. In this clip from Phineas and Ferb, they fly in a large paper airplane so fast that the sun seems to rise quite quickly. How fast are Phineas and Ferb and their friends moving? Well, based on some measurements from the video, I approximated that the sun took 3 seconds to completely rise. Let's assume that Earth isn't moving and do a quick calculation. Since the sun is half of a degree in the sky and took about 3 seconds for the sun to rise, then that would mean 6 seconds would be needed to go around 1 degree of the Earth, and since there are 360 degrees in a circle, only 6 times 360 seconds are needed to travel around the Earth. And that's 24,000 miles in 2,140 seconds, or about 11.1 miles per second. Or in kilometers, about 18.5 kilometers per second. That is fast. How fast? Well, it's past escape velocity by about 50%, which is the speed that an object needs to be launched and escape gravity to never come back to Earth. Escape velocity is about 7 miles per second, or 11 kilometers per second. So I don't think they would have their eyes open during that flight, and they'd probably all be burning up in the atmosphere as well. It's lucky for their friends that Phineas and Ferb know how to break the immutable laws of physics.
I can't believe how fast you built this, Ferb. Of course, breaking the immutable laws of physics is always easier the second time around.
Thank you for watching. Please subscribe and share our videos. Be sure to follow Math the World on Twitter, Instagram, and Facebook. Thank you so much for your support.